Good evening, everyone. My name is Susan Harada. I am the Associate Director of the School of Journalism and Communication at Carleton University and the head of the journalism program there. We begin tonight by acknowledging that we are gathered for this event on the traditional and unceded territory of the Algonquin Nation. Peter Stursberg was a trailblazer, the first to cover Canadian troops in the field during the Second World War, the last living war correspondent from that era at the time of his death in 2014. For those reasons and more, his daughter Judith Laurie and his son Richard Stursberg established an endowed fund with the journalism program at Carleton University. They're both here tonight. Please join me in thanking them. Judith. And right beside her, Richard. You'll hear from Richard in a moment. The fund, though, that Judith and Richard established supports two very special initiatives that speak to the legacy of their father. The first is the Peter Stursberg Award in Conflict Journalism and Media Studies. It will help outstanding Master of Journalism students at our school undertake a thesis or a master's research project on a subject related to media and conflict. The second is this lecture, for which we're gathered here tonight, the new annual Peter Stursberg Foreign Correspondence Lecture is a first for Canada. And so in planning our inaugural event, I could think of no better partner than the Canadian War Museum. When I first met with Stephen Quick, the Director General of the museum, almost a year ago today, as a matter of fact, I prepared a quite lengthy spiel outlining all of the reasons why I thought a partnership would be a really beneficial thing for both of our institutions. And so, as I launched into my sales pitch when I met with him, anticipating that I would have to twist his arm, he leaned forward and smiled and said, "Yes, we're in." So this is why tonight I actually now have the very great pleasure of introducing Stephen Quick to you, to welcome you on behalf of the museum. Stephen.
Thank you, Susan. She just stole the best part of my speech, but that's okay. It's going to be wonderful. And Ms. Doucet, Ms. Harada, Mr. Stursberg, Mr. Kennedy, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and welcome to the Barney Danson Theatre here at the Canadian War Museum during this Remembrance Week. Le musée est fier de vous accueillir ce soir et de présenter cette activité en collaboration avec l'École de journalisme et communication de l'Université de Carleton. In the first part of my career, I was fortunate enough to work on the Massey Lecture Series. As some of you will know, this prestigious event featured a leading writer, philosopher, historian, or other notable Canadian who would give a public lecture supported by a national broadcast and publication on a timely and important subject. Since entering the world of museums, I have been searching for the opportunity to offer just this sort of lecture platform, but until last year, to no avail. A little over a year ago, I met with Associate Director Susan Harada from the School of Journalism and Communication at Carleton, who wanted to chat about an idea that she was working on. And this is where the story links with yours. We met, we exchanged pleasantries. Susan sat across and started her sales pitch. She began with one sparkling sentence, rich with possibilities, but before she could start the next sentence, I exclaimed, to her surprise, "We're in, let's make it happen." What she didn't say was, she then looked at me and said, "But I have a whole presentation to make." I said, "Well, you can go through it, but we're actually going to do it." And she said, "Oh, all right, we'll just move on." And so was born the Peter Stursberg War Correspondent Lecture that we are launching this evening. I want to applaud the insight and dedication of both Associate Director Susan Harada and Mr. Richard Stursberg and his family for developing this incredible event that honors the important work of Richard's father, Mr. Peter Stursberg. The Canadian Museum is absolutely honored to be collaborating on this evening's event, and in welcoming and congratulating the seminar's first guest lecturer, Ms. Lyse Doucet. So welcome, and we are absolutely honored to have you with us. So why the Canadian War Museum, a museum of Canada's military past? Historians of military and social history and journalists share a common goal, to seek truth and be able to present it to a public audience. The historian, for his or her part, combs through the source documents, testimonies, and material culture left to us from the passages of time. The correspondent records history and experiences the conflicts and aftermath as they happen. Historian and correspondent form a symbiotic relationship whose outcome is a greater and more visceral understanding of Canada in this, the 21st century, as it traces the fault lines that brought us here. And what better setting to present their collaborative effort than Canada's National Museum, dealing with armed conflict and how it has shaped this country. A museum that is the nexus where the past meets the present, a living museum. By presenting events like this evening, we open a dialogue on our world and how conflicts shape it and molds our country into the nation we know today. We are intensely proud to work with Carleton and play our part in the presentation of this prestigious and important seminar. Thank you for joining us this evening. Merci d'être parmi nous ce soir. I know that we're all looking forward to tonight's presentation. J'espère que vous allez apprécier la conférence ce soir. Merci.
I'm sure you're all familiar with the name Richard Stursberg. You probably know him best from his former role as the Executive Vice President of CBC's English Services. But tonight, he's here in, I'd say, a more important role. He's here as Peter Stursberg's son. So please welcome him, Richard.
Since we're sharing funny stories, I hadn't planned to tell it, but I'll tell it anyhow. When I first went to the CBC, I think I was the first person to come and run the English side who came from outside the CBC, so I knew I would be warmly received. I knew I'd be particularly warmly received by the newsroom, which at the time was known as Fort News. But to try to assuage their anxieties, I thought, I'll go down to the archives and I'll ask them to find a picture of my father with a CBC microphone. And I'll put it on my wall of my office. And that will convince them that I'm not as wicked as they might imagine. So this very picture was the picture that sat on the wall. It had no impact whatsoever on the news department. I would just say that my father was best known as a war correspondent. But in fact, he had a long career in journalism. After the Second World War, he was the first CBC correspondent to the United Nations. He was the Ottawa editor of the Toronto Star. He owned an affiliated radio news service. He was one of the founders of the CTV news network. So he was very deeply involved in all this, and he wrote many books. It's interesting to your observation about history, the intersection of history and journalism. He wrote a series of histories. Probably the best known are his oral histories of the Diefenbaker regime and his oral histories of the Pearson regime. But all of this took place, most of this work, took place in Ottawa. And the bulk of his career was spent here. So it seemed absolutely the best place to set this up was here in the journalism school in Ottawa. When we were talking to Susan, we talked about the fact that there is very little available in terms of advanced studies on how to cover conflict for journalists. And as conflict becomes less and less conflict between traditional armies and more conflict with non-state players of one variety or another, the ability to be able to figure out how to deal with these things and how to understand them, I think, becomes even more important. So the purpose of this and the purpose of the fellowship that Susan was talking about is precisely to see whether we can open new ground in terms of understanding these issues. I'm thrilled that the War Museum, and Stephen, thank you very much, is part and parcel of this. And I'm also thrilled that Paul Kennedy is here from Ideas and that the CBC Radio is going to be part of it as well. Finally, I just have to say that Susan had set up an extraordinarily distinguished, I think it's fair to say, panel of journalists from around the world, journalists and news directors from around the world, to try to figure out who we should invite to be the speaker. And when Lyse's name came up, I think it's fair to say everybody said, that's absolutely the right and best person. Lyse, as you know, is the senior BBC foreign correspondent. She's also Canadian. And I thought this could be no better choice. So thank you, Lyse, for doing this. And thank you, everybody, for coming this evening. I think there's a little video now. Is that right, Susan? So I'll vacate the stage, and the video comes on. Peter Stursberg was born in China in 1913. His mother was half Japanese and half Irish. And his father was a member of the colonial administration, the British colonial administration in China. So he grew up in a curious kind of imperial household of mixed race and ultimately ended up in Canada when he was in his very early 20s and started his career as a journalist. He had become one of the very first people working for the CBC News. This is around 1938, and the CBC had just set up a news department. And of course, like he would have been at the time in 1938, 25 years old, say. So like everybody, every journalist of the period, when the war broke out, the number one thing they wanted to do was they wanted to go to cover the war. So finally in 1942, they agreed to send him, and in early 1943, he arrived in London. He covered them first of all in the invasion of Sicily, and then as they progressed up Italy and across the so-called Hitler line, so he followed the Canadian troops all through Italy. Then he followed the Canadian troops for the liberation of Holland, and then he ended up in Berlin just shortly after VE Day. And through the course of it all, of course, what he was doing was he was reporting on how the war was going from the point of view of Canada. So it was the first time that people could actually hear what war sounded like. There's a famous piece, my father broadcasting from the Leary line in Italy, where you can hear him say, listen to the guns roar.
Just listen to those guns roar.
And then you hear the guns in the background. So it was actually allowed, and the Canadians were the only ones who had this technology. It actually allowed the Canadians to bring people into the sound of the war in a way that had never happened before.
We're in the attic of an old Italian farmhouse that overlooks the front as it's on a slight ridge. I'm standing here looking out of a hole in the wall that was made by a shell during the fighting here 2 days ago. This house, though, hasn't really been very badly damaged. It's the only one standing that I've seen for miles around.
Peter Stursberg landing in Sicily was the first time a Canadian broadcaster covered Canadian troops on the move. He arrived just in time to cover the liberation of one of the key objectives of the Canadian force that landed in Sicily, the town of Agira, which was liberated in late July 1943. And so he came basically the evening of the battle and was able to get there when the town square had been liberated and the Seaforth Highlanders of Canada pipe band was playing, the church bells in the background, and was able to broadcast for the first time Canadians liberating European city after years of really bad news in the wartime news coming from the CBC and elsewhere, this was quite an event. During the Second World War, radio was the only electronic media. There was print reporting. There was certainly a newsreel and film that had been around for some time, and photographic reporting was certainly available. But radio was at the cutting edge of technology. It was a way to bring, with only a few hours delay in some cases, or at the least a day or more delay, reporting of real live sounds from the battlefield into people's living rooms in a way that had never been the case before. This was done through very bulky, by today's standards, portable recording units that weighed dozens of pounds each, that were carted on a Jeep, that could then be brought to a mobile recording van and all of this sort of thing. But the result was that broadcasters like Stursberg were able to lay live commentary over events as they happened.
It's a great honor for the School of Journalism and Communication to host the annual Peter Stursberg Foreign Correspondents Lecture. We're in the business here of training young journalists, and down the road, some of them will likely end up reporting from conflict zones. The Stursberg Lecture Series is one way of ensuring that when they do, the journalism they produce will be smart and meaningful. Hearing from the best of today's foreign correspondents can't help but inspire journalists of the future to do their best, and hopefully their journalism will also contribute to more informed decision-making around the world.
Well, as Richard mentioned, we have Paul Kennedy here with us tonight. You'll all know him as a longtime and award-winning host of that very wonderful CBC radio program called Ideas. Paul engages Canadians with, as he puts it, the core curriculum of contemporary culture. So we're all very fortunate that he's engaging with us tonight as the moderator of this lecture. Paul?
Thank you, Susan. I want to say first, it's a great honor to be here at the beginning of what I hope will be a very long lecture series going on until there are no wars, which would be a great idea. And maybe we'll do a show about it someday. I often find myself in the somewhat ridiculous position of introducing people who are more famous than I am to an audience who already knows who they are. And that's sort of what I'll be doing here tonight. So in order to prepare myself, I did what every good journalist did. I went onto the web this afternoon, found lots of Wikipedia stuff about this evening's lecturer. What was most interesting, though, is that what first came up was Lyse Doucet's accent. And it was very interesting, obviously, to an international audience to try to figure out who and what she was. And it turns out somebody immediately answered, she's Acadian. And much of the response seemed to be trying to figure out how that relates to a Canadian. And it was somehow an economical way that we'd somehow figured out how to reduce that. And Lord knows what les Canadiens also are there for. And an international audience does not understand that. All of you people do, of course. And what I would like to say by way of introduction, by way of introducing someone who needs no introduction, is to say that that very fact, which was very much on the web this afternoon, not in the way that it perhaps should be interpreted, but was there, indicates to me that this evening's lecture is not just going to be about foreign correspondence and perhaps even war correspondence. It might actually be also a little bit about being a refugee. Because as we Canadians all know, les Acadiens, the Canadians, we're refugees, and it brings everything full square right into a contemporary focus right now. I can feel it, the sort of lines are connecting, and we're looking at what tonight's topic is. And in very short way of introducing Lyse Doucet, I think, to an audience that already knows her is that I think the most recent of the many, many awards she has won, and this is an honor this evening as well, but earlier this year, in 2017, she was awarded in London something called the one of the International Media Awards, which is a huge prize in London and very important in my profession. What's really interesting, though, is that her award in that category came for outstanding contribution to broadcasting. And that's a big, big thing to say about somebody. They've made an outstanding contribution to broadcasting. But when you get into the finer print, it gets even more interesting. That award comes because Lyse contributed to a better understanding in the world in general. And what that does, and this is where the crux of that award comes in and why I think you should definitely put your hands together to welcome tonight's speaker, it was believed that that better understanding in terms of what a foreign correspondent does will actually create greater peace in the world. And that is what we do as journalists, I think, as correspondents, as people who work in war but not at war, about war. Lyse Doucet has taught us that we are really looking for peace, and that's what I hope she's here to tell us this evening. Please welcome the first Stursberg Award winner, Lyse Doucet.
Thank you so much. What a delightfully different kind of introduction, and maybe it's made me feel just like everyone else who's gathered here tonight, because people often say to me, you're Canadian? You don't sound Canadian. And yet what our great novelist Robertson Davies reminded us in one of his well-read novels about all that is bred in our bone, and perhaps in my bones and in the bones of so many of you here tonight, we were all refugees. But I'd like to say, and I hope I speak for everyone here tonight, that here in Ottawa, I feel very much at home. And thank you, Paul, and thank you to all of you, to the Stursberg family, for making me feel at home. Merci beaucoup, mille merci. C'est un très, très grand honneur d'être ici ce soir, to be here with you on this lovely, crisp autumn evening. All of you who have turned out to join us as we pay tribute to one of Canada's finest war correspondents, Peter Stursberg. And it's a great pleasure, where Susan, to be brought back into the family of the Carleton School of Journalism and Communications. I have to confess that when I was a young schoolgirl growing up in New Brunswick, I thought of studying at Carleton University, but let it be said that I spared myself and you the embarrassment of rejection by not applying. But perhaps in a very New Brunswick kind of revenge, my sister Andrea ended up not just studying at Carleton, but teaching there too. So hashtag there you are. Yes. And it is a great honor to be part of this special moment for the Stursberg family. And I want to thank you for giving me this honor to try to step in Peter's very, very big boots. And I was mentioning to Richard, who's Peter's son, that the last time that we met was in one of my favorite places of all on one fine morning in an exquisite courtyard in the evocative city of Jerusalem. And I'm sure it became a favorite place for Richard too. But tonight we gather to talk about what is for us our favorite profession, and that is journalism. Okay, I know it's not everyone's favorite profession, but for tonight, just that you like it, it's, you know, you're interested in it. And tonight we speak not just about journalism, but about storytelling and listening of the hardest kind, that kind of war correspondence or conflict journalism, as Susan Harada describes so eloquently in the brochure that accompanies this lecture. And it's hard because how we wish that wars and war correspondents didn't have to exist. But they do, and how. And tonight, this inaugural lecture tells us what a pioneering role Peter Stursberg played, not just in bringing information about a war, a great war, they called it, into Canadian homes, but he brought the feel of war, the sounds of war, that sense of what it was like to be there. And that is the gold standard for any foreign correspondent and the true test of a good story. And tonight we reflect too on how fortunate we are as Canadians to live in a land at peace, and how perhaps many of us here tonight identify with this as part of our sense of self and place as peacemakers and peacekeepers. But in a place like this, the Canadian War Museum, we also are given a powerful reminder about how wars have also forged our sense of who we are. And this year's memorials, including one here at the Canadian War Museum about the battle at Vimy Ridge 100 years ago, became not just a defining military moment, but a defining moment for our country. And I'm sure you've all seen in the coverage of how historians say that it marked the sense of our birth as a nation, our sense of pride, that sense of how the four corps of the four divisions of the Canadian Corps attacked together in that battle, and they prevailed. But at what a tremendous human cost. And 3 years ago, at about this time, just down the street from where we meet tonight at Parliament Hill, the sudden and shocking series of shootings which erupted, the actions of a disturbed man who was described as having jihadist sympathies with distant wars in the Middle East, in Iraq, in Syria, and Libya. And it was a reminder that we live in a time when we are forever reminded that international news is no longer foreign, that there are threads, both light and dark, which bind us all. But first, let us go back to another time. Let us go to a battle of old, to the Second World War of 1939 to 45, fought on front lines mainly by men, their stories told largely by men. But women were playing roles just behind and far beyond the front lines. Kept out of combat, but they were part of every fight. Women were flying the Spitfires, which took the supplies from the depots to the squadrons. They were working in the hospitals, working at home. They were working at what had been called man's work in the foundries and the factories. And then in 1943, six young men, including 29-year-old Peter Stursberg, were chosen by CBC Radio to cross the Atlantic to go and report on the war from North Africa, from Italy, and then later from Northwestern Europe. And it said that Peter pestered his editors so much to be sent that they may have just sent him just to get rid of him. And he became, as we heard, the first reporter to see action when the invasion of Allied forces began in Italy. But he was also one of the last and one of the very few to visit to report from that bunker where Adolf Hitler died. Six CBC men. There was no gender balance then. Nobody even thought about it. But there was linguistic balance, and that's pretty impressive at the time. There were three male reporters from CBC English, Peter, Matthew Halton, Andrew Cohen, and three men from French, Marcel Huimet, Benoît Lafleur, Paul Barrette. Pas mal. Chapeau pour les hommes. But history is so often her story. There was also Betsy. Actually, they called her Big Betsy. And she made all the difference. Without Betsy, Peter and all of his colleagues wouldn't have been able to broadcast their reports from front lines. And not only that, Betsy, being Betsy, helped the other broadcasters too, including the BBC and some of the American television networks, to record and to edit their dispatches. There was no one else in that World War II press corps than like Betsy from Canada. You see, Betsy was a truck, a broadcast truck, a mobile van in a big army truck, Big Betsy. Now, I don't know if that truck was named after someone's wife, someone's sister, someone's girlfriend. I didn't want to know. I didn't ask. Richard, maybe you can tell me there. But because it's 2017, I want to believe that they called that big broadcast truck Betsy because a formidable presence like that could only be a woman. And it was called portable broadcast equipment, even though it weighed hundreds of pounds. And with its recording turntables and its own source of power, it allowed the CBC and other broadcasters to get as close as safely as possible to the front lines to record their voices over the sounds of war. There was the artillery and the aircrafts, the mortars, the machine gun fire. But there were also, as you saw in the video, the sounds of the bagpipes and the church bells. Sounds so real that Peter later said that Hollywood began to use them. And it was all recorded on discs, passed by the censor, and then sent to the nearest radio station, which often happened to be London, and then broadcast on air across Canada. Betsy made history, literally, helped by the CBC's legendary engineer Art Holmes. And Peter and his colleagues told our history. And history was made for CBC Radio 2. You see, in 1939, when the Second World War erupted, CBC was just a baby, 3 years old. And like any baby, it was just really about singing, dancing, entertainment. Families gathered around the wireless. But war has a way of taking over the airwaves, taking over our lives, and yes, taking lives. There was no television then, no social media. There was newspapers, but they lacked that immediacy, the intimacy, and yes, the impact of radio. It brought the war, the raw sounds of war, into Canadians' tidy homes. And to listen to Peter Stursberg's broadcast is to hear a masterclass in radio. You heard it in that video. Just listen to those guns roar. Just look at the faces who fight. Just listen.
This is Peter Stursberg of the CBC reporting from the Italian front. It's difficult for me to describe the grim struggle that is going on in the mountains above Cassino. I've just been talking with the men who have been there and fought and suffered there. And now that I come to tell the story, I realize how inadequate words are. There's no possible way that I can exaggerate the hardships of this terrible battle. And I'm only afraid that I won't be able to make them sound real enough.
There is only the fear, he says on a front line, that my words won't be real enough. And that, as Paul I'm sure will confirm, that is the real fear of any correspondent. Do I have the words to do this justice? Do I have the words to convey what I see? I can still see, Peter says, the strained look on the faces of men who've just come out of the hills of hell. Hills of rough stones and small pebbles which scrunched and slid underfoot. Hills he described as heavy with the stench of death. And during what was known as hunger winter, on the fringe of the famine zone in the Dutch city, the village of Apeldoorn, Peter tells us, I've just visited a home in Apeldoorn, and I must admit I didn't believe the good Dutch housewife when she showed me her shopping list. The figures she jotted down, he said, were ridiculous. 10 guilders, $4 for a single loaf of bread. A fortune, then. And then he's there, right there, the journalist's proverbial right place, right time, when the suffering finally ends for 3.5 million Dutch residents on the brink of starvation.
This is Peter Stursberg reporting to the CBC from Holland. Now that the news blackout has been lifted, I can tell you the full story of the extraordinary conference which resulted in the agreement on feeding the starving Dutch. I was at this dramatic meeting. You know, it was the first full-dress meeting between the Allies and the Nazis in this war. As a matter of fact, Ned Nordness of the Associated Press and myself were the only correspondents to enter the schoolhouse of the little Dutch village on the Greber line and see friend and foe sitting around some rough wooden tables, talking instead of fighting.
Even in war, journalists can't forget when they have a scoop. But war is dark and distant, but it's also deeply personal and very small, and sometimes as small as a loaf of bread. The details of war that all of us can understand. And an understanding, too, that at moments of the world's greatest inhumanity can also be times of the most searing and simple of humanity. Because at a time of death, what matters is life. And if Peter was here tonight, what would we say? We'd say, come on, Peter, tell us what your favorite story was of all. Since he can't be here, and if he was here at the age of 105, he would tell this story, and so in his place, I'll humbly tell it. And it is, again, a story which is not just history, but her story too. Her name was Marlene, Lily Marlene. It was a German love song, a song of the enemy. A soldier's promise to his sweetheart that he'd meet her at the lamppost. Every night at precisely 9:55 on Belgrade radio, they played the song. And German soldiers in the dark of night in their trenches sang it. And soon the Allied forces began to sing it as well. They didn't understand all the words, but they understood its haunting tune.
Vor der Kaserne, vor dem großen Tor, stand eine Laterne und steht sie noch davor. So wollen wir uns da wiedersehen bei der Laterne wollen wir stehen, wie einst Lili Marleen, wie einst Lili Marleen,
outside the barracks by the corner light. I'll always stand and wait for you at night. We will create a world for two. I'll wait for you the whole night through. For you, Lily Marlene. For you, Lily Marlene. When Peter arrived in Sicily, he realized that even the peasants in the fields were singing Lili Marleen. And so somehow he managed, between covering the Sicily campaign and the Italian campaign, he managed to get together a local orchestra, including a local tenor, to record the song. And he managed to do what his BBC colleagues failed to do: recording Lili Marleen, slipping it past the censors, getting it out of the war zone to London, and then to Canada and on the air. For you, Lili Marleen. For you, Lili Marleen. And years later, when Peter would play that song, he said it would remind him of dark nights in Sicily, of darker silhouettes of olive trees. It would remind me, he says, of the rain and the mud, the sound of the guns, and comrades of old. Lili Marleen gave the soldiers hope that one day they would go home and go home alive. And so they did, soldiers and correspondents too. And when Peter did, he realized that all those years when he wondered, as he said that he spoke into what seemed like a barrel, he wondered, was anyone listening? And when he got back to Canada, he realized pretty well everyone was. He had become what we call a household name. Household name. It seems so quaint now. It was about a time where we really did sit in our homes, where we'd have our ears pressed against the radio, and then when television was invented, our eyes would be glued to the set, and we'd be sitting on the sofa, often as a family, watching the news. And aside from our occasional lapses in watching U.S. television, Canadians were watching, listening to the same news from coast to coast, along with Mr. Dress-Up, Friendly Giant, Look Up, Way Up, Charlie Brown, Front Page Challenge, and more. How things have changed. A younger generation isn't buying television sets anymore. Many of you watch TV on your smartphones. Some of you don't watch TV at all. Or you can watch whatever you like, however you like, whenever you like, on live streams, on a myriad of social media platforms. And it's all on these things, these smartphones. And The Economist magazine reported this week that Americans, on average, touch their smartphone 2,600 times a day. 2,600 times. And the heavy users do it almost double that. Now, I'm not sure if that is a statistic which makes us different or just like Americans. But technology, as we know it, helps us and it hurts us. I've used a phone like this to report from a suicide bombing in Damascus, to report from a battle on the edge of the Syrian city of Homs. I used it when I was rushing to catch my plane to come to Ottawa, and I just stood in a corner, picked up the phone, went to the app, and they did an interview on the BBC analyzing the latest crisis in the Middle East. In 1943, there were six correspondents for CBC News on the radio. Now there are millions, gazillions, as a child would say, who can tell us Canadians what is happening anywhere in the world. And anyone with a smartphone can send their story now. Nobody needs Big Betsy anymore. Never have we been able to know so much, but never have we struggled to find out what is really happening. There is so much information, too much information, and so much misinformation, misunderstanding, manipulation, often coming from that unrelenting stream of social media, raw, unverified. Sometimes, even journalists like me want to turn the radio off, turn the computer off, turn away. But this is what we know, that wars are monstrous. Peter told us that when he reported from the gaping hole inside a farmhouse wall. Today we hear upon city, town upon town in Iraq, flattened in the battle against so-called Islamic State. Towns and cities where there isn't IS anymore. Towns and cities where it's not fit for anyone to live anymore. And that conflicts are also at once humanitarian disasters, and where people are the most powerful weapon of all. The villagers in Dutch villages who starved during the Second World War. People starving tonight in a neighborhood of Damascus in Ghouta. In city center, the restaurants are full of light and food. In Ghouta, the cupboards are dark and empty, and the children are crying. We also know that we are in a time when the world has beaten smallpox, almost eradicated polio, contained Ebola, and is making advances against AIDS. And yet it is a time where the fastest explosion of cholera on record is taking place in Yemen because of a war. And we know that it's a time when all of us here tonight understand the importance of education, of keeping children in schools. And yet it is a time where the UN tells us that 671 million children around the world and young people don't really know how to read and write, and they can't do basic maths. 671s, 18 times the population of Canada. 18 Canadas, and that is our shared future. The statistics tell us that our world is a more peaceful place now, and that is progress. But the wars which go on are forever wars, destroying the hopes and dreams of entire generations. And some of you here tonight may know that all too well. My sister Paula, who's a deputy principal at a primary school in New Brunswick, once asked me, "What do I need to know? What do I really need to know about Syria?" I said then, and I will say tonight, that as Peter Stursberg told us decades ago, that wars are about stories of families just trying to survive, of fighters who just want to go home, stories about mothers and fathers and children too. But most of all, we need to know that wars that seem so far from us are not far from us at all. That the consequences of wars and conflicts and disasters are in our schools and they're on our streets. They're in the refugees that Canadian citizens have so generously sponsored. They're in the asylum seekers and the migrants who grow up here, and they make a difference. But it's also in the new threats that we face and the concerns we all share, from climate change to terrorism. And in order for all these stories to be told, in order for stories to exist, there have to be storytellers too. I met one a few weeks ago, and his story stays with me. His work featured in the Toronto Star, and he's been invited to come to Canada by the Global Reporting Center at the University of British Columbia. His name is Ali Arkady. I didn't meet him in person, but through a message he recorded for the Rory Peck Awards for freelance journalists, which takes place every year in London. Ali is an Iraqi photojournalist, and he embedded with an elite Iraqi unit fighting in the country's war against so-called Islamic State. Ali wanted to do a story about the good guys. He wanted to tell a happy story, for a country which has so few. But the good guys turned out to be the bad guys, or at least some of them. The soldiers who murdered, who tortured. His photographs are chilling. The children crying in dirty corners, in dark rooms. The suspects suspended from the ceiling, beaten and bloodied, screaming their innocence. And when the soldiers who did that found out that Ali would publish these photographs, there were death threats, and he hesitated. But he realized he had to go, and he fled in the middle of the night from his home in Baghdad with his wife, his young child, small suitcase, his computer, and a hard drive. And the editor from ABC News, Rhonda Schwartz, called Ali in his place of hiding, and she said, "Ali, we're prepared to put this story aside. We can wait." And Ali replied, "No, Rhonda, it's just the opposite. You must hurry. You must hurry. If the world cannot see and hear what I documented, it is all for no good." His photos were published in major newspapers worldwide, including the Toronto Star. His story was broadcast on media worldwide, including the CBC radio program, The Current. Ali's story of Iraqi troops is our story too. Those troops were trained by a coalition, including Canadian, British, American, and other soldiers too. There are many good men who've been trained, but there are bad ones too, committing what are war crimes. And now, because of Ali's photographs, an investigation is underway, and prosecutions are expected. The judges at the Rory Peck Award said, "This goes to the very heart of what it is to be a journalist, the desire to tell the truth." But the Rory Peck Awards and many others like it tell us year in, year out, how hard that is to do. The death threats, the kidnapping, the violence, the visa restrictions. At the Rory Peck Awards this year, every single award highlighted brave and unflinching journalists from the worst wars of our time in Iraq and in Syria, from conflicts in places like Bolivia, from humanitarian disasters like the Rohingyas fleeing from the violence which has burnt their homes in Myanmar. And this year, just like every year, every film came from a dark place. Every film but one. One film came from a place of bright lights, cream-colored rooms, men and women in suits. It came from a new front line of our time, the White House press room. In a film by the British freelancer Ollie Lambert, entitled "The President Versus the Press." We all know the weapons and the ammunition in this battle, and it's not just about President Trump. It's accusations of fake news, real fake news, charges that we, the mainstream media, or MSM as they call us, are losers, fakers, frauds. It's not just a new threat, it's an existential threat. It's a battle of our time for journalists who report the news, for citizens who consume it. Another journalist I met at the Rory Peck Awards was Katie Tour. Me, who often reports from physical front lines around the world. She, a journalist with the US television network, the NBC, who was not just singled out during the election campaign by then President Trump, she was targeted. And her new book, Unbelievable, My Front Row Seat to the Craziest Campaign in American History, is scary. How do you fight fake news when people refuse to accept the facts, I asked her, when we prepared for the awards in London. And this was her reply. It's like when a believer tries to convince an atheist that God exists. There's nothing you can do to convince them, not even when there are facts. This year, the new word for the Oxford Dictionary was fake news. Last year, the new word was post-truth. The technology which has transformed all of our lives and journalism too now challenges it. Social media once held out the promise of bringing all of us closer together. It once seemed to hold the power which we saw in those momentous protests we once called the Arab Spring to be a peaceful force for change. Now social media is tearing us apart. Online trolls, automated computer bots who post fake news, computer warriors. Instead of creating empathy, it's creating emotion and anger. And then there's the online news feeds chosen by computer algorithms, not people, who can't identify and delete all the stories which aren't true, which can't pick out all the forms of hate speech. And there's Facebook's admission that Russian trolls purchased 3,000 ads during the US presidential campaign. That was 80,000 pieces of content viewed by 126 million Americans. It's not just a threat to journalism, it's a threat to democracy. And the fight back has started. There's pressure on Facebook and Google not just to use these algorithms to choose their news feed. There's also an increase in subscriptions for daily newspapers. But it still has to be said that many local ones, including here in Canada, are shutting down or shedding jobs as advertising revenues are swallowed up by new media giants like Facebook and Google. And it all comes down to our journalism too, that we need to do a better job of telling stories from all sides, about the people who are racing ahead and the people who get left behind, about the stories which seem far from our shores, but in reality are about all of us. And we need to do everything possible to ensure that our own stories aren't fake or false. At journalism schools the world over, including here at Carleton University, they teach young students the five W's: who, what, when, where, why, the facts. And in a world like ours, there's a sixth new W, WTF. What? This is on CBC Radio, so I'm not spelling it out. Hashtag OMG, hashtag unbelievable. But there's also a seventh W, wow. The stories which take our breath away. They make us pause. They make us laugh or cry. They make us think. And sometimes they may even make us act. We live in a time where when it comes to journalism, everything has changed and nothing has changed. In 1943, 74 years ago, CBC sent six young men, including 29-year-old Richard Stursberg, to the battlefields of Europe so that they could become the trusted voices of a war which mattered to us all. They had to earn that trust, our trust, and they did. There's a saying in our profession that you're only as good as your last story. In fact, we're only as good as our next one. This is a time for journalists where we have to do what we do even better. To keep painting pictures of victories and defeats, and the battles big and small, which make all of us who we are. Thank you.
I think a standing ovation is an eloquent expression of thank you for what you've just given us. A truly wonderful lecture.
Thank you.
I have some time to begin a question period, and I think there may be some chance at the end for a few questions from the audience as well. But I want to begin sort of where you began, and that was five Canadian guys going off to cover a war. And you repeatedly pointed out, oh, there was her story.
I talked about facts, episode six.
Six, sorry, a fact checker here. Ideas is always slightly behind on facts.
So. My mother has to pay for the CBC, you know, so we must get it right.
Because six guys go off to war, but you pointed out at least two or three times, you said it's her story too, And what I want to ask you about, and it wasn't necessarily a topic of the lecture, but it's something that you're more than capable of commenting on. Why are there so many female war correspondents? And it does go back to this, goes back before the Second World War, but you know, Gellhorn was the big voice in the Second World War. Then it comes on, and in Canada, you know, and I can speak as a CBC radio person, you know, Anna Maria Tremonti and Carol Off both cut their teeth in war zones. And you're not an exception either, although you don't work for the CBC. Mm. Why are women in some ways overrepresented in that category and have been for a long time?
Is this turning from analysis into complaint now? Hashtag way to go, men. We grew up with Anne Medina, you know, who was reporting from Lebanon. Barbara Frum, of course, was a heroine for us all. But I'm so relieved you put it that way, because, and with all due respect, if there are any journalism students here who were planning to call me up, is that they call up and say, hi, I'm doing a report about gender in journalism, and I'd like to know too about women war correspondents. And I think we have come to the time where that our journalism should not be defined by our gender, but it should be defined by who we are. And this is actually something which I didn't talk about, but I was quite interested in Peter's time, because I often say that for me what defines journalism is the questions that we ask. And the questions come from who we are, about where we grew up, about our own history. And so Peter's history was so interesting because he brought together so many different cultures, and he himself was an immigrant too. And I'm sure that fed into the kinds of questions he was asked, what he looked for, you know, perhaps it was what inspired him when he heard the peasants singing Lili Marlene, that he realized this was something that struck such a chord for the soldiers, for the people. It was really part of the music of the war, if you like. So when it comes to women, there are so many good women journalists now. Doing, you mentioned, you know, some of my friends who, you know, some of my very good friends, Anna Maria Tremonti, Carol Off, you know, Adrian Arsenault, who's now with the new anchors on the National. We often met on different fronts around the world, different stories. And the new generation has so many women correspondents. And I think it's a very good thing, because I think we need men, we need women, we need people from all kinds of different backgrounds, because the more different questions we ask, the more we'll be better informed about the stories of our time.
And I suppose it doesn't really have a gender issue. I mean, I'm allergic to bullets. you know, it's probably why I'm the host of Ideas, right? Like these are really imaginary bullets or whatever that I have. Carol Off is a good friend of mine. She sort of, I won't say she loves bullets, but she really doesn't mind having them fly over her head. And that's something that bothers me. And it's an interesting dilemma that among the people I know who have been attracted, not to foreign correspondency, but to war correspondency, many of them have been women.
Yes, because this used to be my reply when I would get called by journalism students who were doing their thesis on women war correspondents. And by the way, for the record, I don't regard myself as a war correspondent. I'm a correspondent who sometimes covers elections and sometimes
we have
covers,
too many wars. So
yes, and sometimes covers conflict. And my wish would be that I cover more elections than I'm covering conflicts. But my answer would always be that I know as many men who are interested in the human side of war as I know women who are interested in the ballistics of war. And even though I know you say you're allergic to bullets, but let me give you a little bit of an exclusive bit of information tonight, that bullets don't have names on them and they don't have gender assigned to them. So actually the bullets that were you said you're allergic to, they would probably be heading either for you or for Carol with no distinction. But it still remains to be said, and again, this is back to who we are as journalists. Some people, you know, for example, in my case, that I think one of these qualities or the skills that I have, if I have any, is that I come from New Brunswick. I come from a place where people are really friendly, they talk to people, they ask questions to people. I mean, anyone who takes the train from Ottawa to Halifax knows that when the train leaves the station from Montreal, suddenly the carriages become more chatty, more talkative, more laughing. And when I went to school at University of Queen's, you know, many Canadians said to me, "Oh, you come from New Brunswick. I thought Canada stopped in Montreal. And it wasn't a joke, actually. But who we are as people, and being female or male is part of that. But it still has to be said that there are some parts of the world, very traditional societies, very conservative societies, where access to women is controlled by the men. And those are areas where women do have an advantage, because they can both get the trust of the men who hold the keys to the door, but also the women, because if you're in at times of war, and often not even at times of war, when you're asking people to tell you their most intimate secrets, that, and it's a universal human thing, that women find it easier to talk to other women. And it's very interesting in what will be seen as one of the greatest reminders, if one was needed, of the power of journalism, is that in the two journalists, Megan Toohey and Jody Cantor, who wrote the two New York Times stories, who wrote the story about 30 years of abuse by Harvey Weinstein, they said that it helped that they were women, because they were talking to other women. They had a female editor. It's not the only reason. The main reason was that they did good journalism. And when they were asked, "Why did you do these stories?" And this is truly a story which has gone viral. It has given a new meaning to the word viral around the world. When they were asked why they did this story, they replied, "We did it for our daughters. Mm-hmm. We did it because we want our daughters to grow up in a world safer for women, and it should be added, safer for men as well."
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the New Brunswick friendliness is something that was an advantage. When I was floundering around trying to introduce you, mentioned the possibility of a sort of a historical or almost ethnic background as a refugee. And do you think that has actually helped you look at the world as a foreign correspondent for the BBC? I mean, do you bring this, not baggage, but lens on the world that comes from being raised as an Acadian, which gives you sensitivity to sensible matters that are very much present?
I think when you study history, and I think it behoves all of us to know where we come from, because it is very much a big part of who we are, you can't help but be taken by the history of the Acadians, the history of any peoples who've been forced from their homes, and that would include the First Nations of Canada as well. Everyone who loses their sense of self or place from not being able to go back to where all of their memories began is a huge jolting experience, and an experience, I'm sure, which is seared in their sense of self. But I do have to say that, you know, when I left Canada and first went to Africa to try to become a journalist, and then I would keep coming back to Canada, but in between those years, I'd keep meeting people who weren't able to go home. I have to say that I think one of the greatest gifts of all is to be able to go home. I mean, the fact that I can get on a plane, come, you know, fly to Ottawa, and then fly back to London, England, where I live now, it seems like such a simple thing, but it is something which is denied to millions of people around the world, not being allowed to go home. Can you imagine that? When you can, who in this audience, if you want to say, cannot go home? Is there anyone here tonight? Is there a few? Well, we're all very lucky if we can.
Very lucky.
Yeah.
There was one. I want to push another thing, and this is very self-serving, I guess, but you were talking about Peter Stursberg. You were talking about a great, not a renaissance, a naissance of Canadian correspondence in a foreign setting. And You were talking about radio. You were talking about the sounds of the guns, the sounds of the bagpipes, the sounds of the church bells. Now, I full disclosure right up front, yes, I work in radio. And you work in both. Predominantly, I would think, though, as a television journalist, you're defined as such. Do you compare the two media in terms of their expressibility? I mean, what if you were to choose? Let's imagine a new war, someplace on another continent that doesn't exist, someplace. But you were sent there to correspond, to tell us what was happening. Would you rather have a microphone or a camera?
I do online.
You'd rather have none.
Yeah, no, that's it. No, I'll do online. All right.
Oh, okay. Online. That's the future.
No, I don't think probably everyone. A lot of people here live with both TV, radio, and of course more
online
with
now.
Our digital lives. But you know, in terms of my own reporting, since you asked, I always think of bringing radio to television and bringing television to radio, which is that when I do television, I think about bringing the kind of analysis and the context that we're so much more easy, it's easier to do on radio because you have more time. But with radio, I think bringing television to it, to paint the pictures, to tell people what I'm seeing, the red flower in the bush, the pink scarf worn by the girl, the toy that's been left in the dark mound of rubble. Because it's that whole thing and this is what I loved when Peter Stursberg, the kind of dispatches they did in the Second World War were much longer, and I think they had greater liberty. And they told us everything when he confessed to his insecurity, can I read, can I do this justice? There's no way I can exaggerate the hardship of this terrible war. And will my words be real enough? And it's a painting of a picture on radio and not analyzing it on television. So I think you need both to kind of develop all the skills that you need to be kind of as a journalist, you're kind of an envoy being sent by others who either don't want or can't go to the places that we go, and so your job is to really to bring back. It's a huge it's a privilege, but it's also a responsibility to convey the fullness of what you see.
And what's amazing, particularly about that golden age, and it was a real golden age. I mean, we were in the green room just before it came in, and it was wonderful to watch Lyse because she's going over her notes, and I could sense the excitement as you relived hearing those reports. And those reports
I
are
I love
from,
listening to those. I love listening to the reports, too.
Yeah, what it does is it takes you back in a way that I'm a lapsed historian. I was previously in, so yeah. Journalism is, I guess, the front lines of history. This is we lay down the front lines.
First rough draft, yes.
But what it does is it brings it back in full sort of sensual glory, and you can see it all or feel it all. Whether you see it if you're listening to radio, or feel it or hear it while you're watching television, it's all there, and it's a great privilege to do that.
Yeah, I was really struck by it because if you think about how long ago that was, but if you were teaching a journalism class, he did a lot of the things that you would tell journalists today, focus on those little details, draw your listeners in, and he used all these different advices. And that when he said, listen to the roar of the guns, he said, come with me, listen to me. I want you to stop, stop what you're doing, listen to me, listen to those guns. And then you hear all the sounds that Big Betsy was able to mix, and then it was really revolutionary, for radio then to be able to mix so that you have the sound of the correspondent's voice and the sounds of the war behind them. And it seems so simple now, but actually that was the first time that they did that sort of thing.
And what was wonderful, I mean, I learned that from Peter, from Richard, talking about Peter earlier this evening, I guess from Peter too, but what was that Canadians were, in a sense, on a cutting edge of the technology, so that what Peter Stursberg was doing in Italy or in Holland or wherever he was also being picked up and heard in Britain and heard all through the United States. And so, in a sense, the technology and the fact that we were there doing it meant that Canadians were bringing the war not just to the radios and living rooms and kitchens of Canada, but also to the rest of the Allied effort in some ways. I mean, we were very much
covering it for
Canada.
The BBC didn't have that technology. The American networks didn't have that technology. It was, plucky Canadian engineers and technicians who came up with that you know, the person they call Big Betsy, that it really was in its time. It was, as you say, it was cutting edge. So I think it's something to be proud of, because here it is, Canada, the colony, both Britain and France, ended up, you know, at least beating them at what was an important part of the war effort. So I think it's, and actually I hadn't realized that, I don't know whether people hear, that a Canadian invented radio. I didn't realize until I was actually looking through, was it Reginald Fessenden?
Fessenden.
Yeah, they actually invented radio. I had never known that. How many people knew that? Oh, oh my God.
More than Dumbo. I don't have a place to go home. I want to spend a few moments, just a few, talking about Ali, too, because I thought that was a really wonderful thing to bring up. And you said something about him that I think was really profound, and that was that he learned that the good guys were the bad guys.
Oh, his story, really. Again, people who care. When you have to pick up everything and leave your home and not knowing whether you can go back. And for him, in that kind of a close-knit traditional society, to be a journalist, most of all, huge, brave, beyond brave. He paid such a heavy personal price. But he was so, so invested with this sense of, you know, I've seen this. You know, he was brought into that unit. They trusted him. They saw him as one of the family. So they started doing things in front of him that he should never have seen, and I'm sure he never wanted to see. But having seen them, he thought that this is something the world should see. Extraordinary.
I'll ask one more question. I don't know if there's time for more from the floor, but
thanks. Thanks.
I loved your seven W's, which I'd never heard before. I mean, obviously I heard about the five. I never went to journalism school, but
they don't teach the six in journalism school.
And it might not make it onto the radio either. But number seven really impressed me, yeah. And it impressed me because, I'm the host of a program called Ideas. That means I guess I'm supposed to have big thoughts, and they're all at least multisyllabic. Wow is probably the word that comes out of my mouth more often than any other word, and I feel marginally embarrassed by that sometimes. That I should have bigger words, or I should have.
No, everyone understands it.
But it is what keeps me in journalism, I guess. And if what I'm doing is journalism, then don't tell anybody, because they might have to pay me for it. But wow is something that is the factor that I find most exciting, not just in what I do, which has not a lot to do with war, or even with foreign relations or foreign affairs. And it brings me into what you do, too. Mm. I mean, I think wow is a common factor among all journalists, and praise the Lord, or whatever, mm-hmm. Thank you. It's wonderful to have shared it, and I think...
You can steal it from me.
I didn't steal it, no, but you have a real wow factor, and it won't go away. It won't go away, will it? I mean,
you're only as good as our next story. I mean, maybe my next one, people say, "Wow, she's really lost it."
What is your next story?
Going to Saudi Arabia.
Wow. I don't know if there is. Is there time, Susan, for more questions or? Yes. Okay. Yes.
Montana Hunter from King's College in London. First of all, thank you very much.
Were you on my flight?
No, I now live in Ottawa as of very recently. I had the privilege of working with a young journalist in Ukraine while I was there about a year ago. Christopher Allen was his name. And I've been thinking about him quite a lot because last week I listened to his funeral. He was killed while embedded in a unit in Sudan. So my question for you, I guess, is how do we balance the importance of being in person and reporting on conflicts in the world with the danger there of the unconventional wars going on right now? Thank you.
It's a big, big, thank you very much for your question. There's a very old maxim in war reporting, which probably goes back to the very first wars that first war correspondents covered. And that is that no story is worth dying for. But we live in a time where we say, but there are stories that are worth taking risks for. And the problem is, and this is, I'm sure, is what happened, is that, tragically, is that you often don't really know the risks or don't want to know the risks until it's too late. And then you do pay the biggest of price. But it's a hard, hard thing. And I've said, even 20 years ago when I was in Afghanistan, I used to say that the bravest journalist of all is the journalist who says, I'm not going in that helicopter. I know everyone else in the press pack is going in that helicopter, but I'm not going because I don't think it's safe enough. And I'm not going in that convoy into a contested zone because I don't believe it's safe enough. There's pressures from your colleagues, pressures from the editors, but I think more and more, I know at the BBC, and I'm sure at CBC as well, in fact, the opposite is happening. I was talking to some NBC journalists who told me that they're only allowed to stay 6 hours in Kabul because it's too dangerous, and even some BBC people who went stayed 2 hours. So people are pulling back, and but as you say, it's where to find that balance. It's a big question.
Another question?
I'm a Carleton student. I'm not in journalism though, so pardon me if this is a bit of an amateur question. With regards to your kind of 5+ W's, and how you use those, or I guess any journalist would use those as a vehicle for delivering truth, really. Mm. How would you go about doing that in a situation where, for example, the why is so subjective and it's never really a one-dimensional issue? How do you interpret truth and then put that forward in your work?
The why is very interesting. I've been thinking about why recently. This is not something that I talked about here, but there was something else I was looking at. And so I'm not a person who likes to look, I've never been interested in Star Trek and Star Wars, looking at the future. But suddenly, in my own profession, what's called robot journalism is starting. And there's been a prediction that in 5 years, a computer could win a Pulitzer Prize, and that 90% of our stories could be written by computers. But one thing the computer can't do now, they can do, because you feed them the data, who, what, when, where, they can't do the why. They can't think or analyze or interpret. They're working on it, but that's the one thing, one of many things that separates us from those machines. And you're right, the why is the context, and that's where prejudices, biases, the facts, you know, that you want to, you can give preference to some facts over some facts. I mean, at the BBC and at the CBC, we're kind of on the one hand, on the other hand, we're supposed to give context, which is different from having an opinion. But you have to work really hard. And I think we can't say that just because we're the so-called mainstream media that we know storytelling better than the rest, because we are very selective too in our choice of the facts. And I am always, always reminded that when I do one more interview, that my perception of the story, the way the story should go, always changes. And you know, we have this expression in journalism, and for some people it's not just an expression, the story that's too good to check, that you think, wow, it's so fantastic, wow, you know, I'm not gonna call and find out if it's true. And you know, and it's, you know, and it's, you know, there's one of the TV channels in Britain whose mantra is never wrong for long. You know, just get it, just get it out there and okay, it's wrong, we'll just get on to the next story. But you're absolutely right. You should apply for journalism school.
Hi, you've talked a lot about storytelling tonight and evoking emotions in people, since giving people facts and stories doesn't usually move them. So there's been a movement towards storytelling in journalism, but I'm wondering what you can say about how far you go with that and how you avoid kind of manipulating people's emotions, since that is a common thread in misinformation and fake news, is trying to manipulate people's emotions. Mm. How do you use some of that without going over the line?
We have to be, could I just be really trite and trivial for just a moment? There's been a mystery to me that people say that what defines Canadians is how they say about, and you pronounced it, about or whatever. It was exactly very Canadian, so that's it. That's it. Please, could you please give me that bit of the recording? Because that's what I was doing. But your question is very good. I fundamentally believe that all of these complicated, complex, consequential stories of our time are, when you drill down to them, human stories. And when I began in journalism, I always reminded myself, this is to be a story that my mother is interested in, who lives in New Brunswick, very far from a lot of the places that I go to. So I think that's how we can begin to understand and, as importantly, care, but more importantly, care about stories. But there is a danger, and you're right to point it out, that in just focusing on the human side of it, the emotion, that you don't give the broader context. And this was a problem in Syria, where the Western media tended to focus on the very real human story, whereas the Russian and the Chinese and other media focused on the terrorism story. And in order to really understand the story of Syria, for example, the siege of the city of Aleppo and the bombardment of the rebel-held east by Russian and Syrian warplanes, the full story was, yes, that children were being targeted in the hospitals, the clinics, and the homes, because that's where the bombs were falling. But people also had to understand what was the politics of the place, which groups were controlling the area, which ones were linked to Al-Qaeda, where was Islamic State, and it doesn't take away from the fact that terrible things, terrible potential war crimes were being committed, and not just by one side in this war. But you also have to understand what is driving this war, where is it heading, who are the various sides in this war, and where are they going to take the war. So it's always finely balanced. And the problem with television is that it tends to go for the short, simple, stark narrative, and which on, you know, radio you always have more time. So you want to have something which draws people in on TV, and that means you sometimes tell the strongest story of all without all of the necessary details, which is why we should also be having long reads, we should be watching TV documentaries. In a world in which we seem to have so little time, we do have to make time to try to see the bigger picture. But that's a good question, thank you. Such good questions in this audience. The Canadian War Museum must be attractive.
Unfortunately, there's time for one more question, but.
There's always the one right here. my question, and a part of it is already, you already answered, is the challenges that face not just international journalists, but all journalists of all stripes in this day and age of social media, where the people consume news just as they consume instant noodles. You know, we live in a time where people want quick, 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 don't really have the time necessarily to go deep into the insights. And a related question is, with so many conflicts going on in the world, how do you prioritize? You know, why is it that Mogadishu, where 350 people lost their lives a couple of weeks ago, only receives 2 minutes of coverage, whereas an attack on Paris that kills 20 people, or an attack on New York where some lone madman runs over and 8 people lose their lives, seems to go on days and days? Do we live in a time of desensitization? Is it the case that 10 people who lose their lives in a Western world, is that a bigger story than 350 people who die in an Asian or in an African country? Is it who you make the shots, or who decides that? Sorry, that might be a bit of a rant.
Is there a third PhD thesis you'd like me to talk about? First of all, social media. It is a challenge. It is a huge challenge to journalism and to who we are as consumers. You know, there's a lot. The research is being done now is how, because we're accessing it on our smartphone, I mean, apparently, and we're constantly challenging our editors at the BBC, they say the average time, and I don't have the exact figures, but it's roughly, people spend 20 seconds. They go to a video, and if they don't like what they see, they just keep, you know, wipe, wipe, wipe. And what's happening, not just at the BBC, but I think at the CBC too and others, is that we do these carefully crafted, edited films from wherever we are, the best of our journalism. And then the BBC takes them and hacks it up and puts a minute 30 on the mobile use or the computers. And it has to start with a very sharp image, a face or something human, And we say, come on, this is the best of our journalism. Why don't you put up the 4-minute piece? They say, nobody's going to watch it. And we say, yes, they are going to watch it. And they say, no, they're not going to watch it. They want the 1:30, you know, wipe. And they won't stay with it unless it really grabs them. And this, I think, it's that classic question which has been asked since time eternal about, are we giving people what they want, or are people taking what we give them? You know, I fundamentally believe, and there's lots of information coming out, that people are reading long reads, and that people do want to understand more than just, as we say, the clickbait. But there's a lot of scientific research now about, in the same way that our journalism is becoming smaller bites, that our attention span is coming in smaller bites. And there's long been this discussion about attention versus information, and our attention spans are now so quick that it's fracturing both our sense of the world and where we consume information, and it has huge consequences if it continues the way it is. But you know, I was recently at, every year in London they have these proms, and the BBC, you know, the best of classical music, and the BBC invites people to come and sit in one of their boxes. So I was in one of them, and a person from The Economist was there. And I introduced myself, and I said, you all know The Economist, serious journalism. And I thought, oh God, someone was going to help me, ammunition. So I said, you know, I'm so worried. You know, in between one opera to the next, I said, so worried, you know, the BBC now. Can you imagine? 1:30 for, you know, the best of our journalism. And so I'm sitting there expecting him to say yes. He goes, 1:30? He goes, wow, that's a long time. We do 30-second ones. And I thought, oh, my goodness. And on the Mogadishu question, it is shameful. It is shameful. That was, even for a country torn by war, that absolutely shattered, as you know, Somali society. And at a time when it was just beginning to make progress in trying to allow people to have a life worth living. But again, these are questions that people have pondered and argued about for time immemorial. And if you had here, sitting here, and I don't know, maybe you'd be the one, or maybe Richard will be the one who says, listen, people will say, 350 in Mogadishu, they're always dying in Mogadishu. I'm being crude now, this is not what I say. You know, hundreds are dying, they've been dying for decades. But Paris, people never die in Paris like that. There's never been 20 people dying in Paris. There was, I was with one of our colleagues from our BBC Persian service, and she had been at an explosion in a schoolyard very close to where children were gathering in Iraq. And she called up London and said, I have never seen anything like this. And people on the ground are saying they have never seen any of this. The carnage on the ground. And then London says, oh, sorry, can't talk to you. Two people have died. And, you know, sorry, we can't, you know, two people have died in London. And it's always said to be, it's the kind of the barometer of how different is this story? Is this something which surprises us, shocks us? Does it take us away from our understanding of the usual state of affairs, if you like? But there is also, and I think we can't just be negative tonight, because the fight back has started, and there are now many people on social media. And this is where social media is a great gathering of great ideas, and not just ideas, but things to do. People, you know, are, and unfortunately, it's maybe a little bit of it is just sort of computer active, you know, being a computer warrior. But people are pointing it out and saying, look, you know, we have to be concerned about this. And people are talking about it. And that is where social media is a great gift of our time. It's a huge global forum where we can discuss those kinds of issues and push back. And I'm a big believer in that the more that we ask questions, the more we'll get the better answers to the questions and the problems of our time. So thank you for asking those questions tonight. And I'll look forward to reading your PhD thesis on them.
Thank you. And Susan, would you like to close the evening?
Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lyse, for a wonderful, riveting lecture, as always. Thank you, Paul, for your excellent moderation.
Thank you.
A few quick things, because I know we've kept you late. From Carleton, I'd like to extend our thanks to Andre Plourd, Dean of the Faculty of Public Affairs. to Rebecca Murray over here, who was instrumental in helping Judith and Richard. to our production team, Karen Kelly and Leo Solano, responsible for the video you saw and the programs you're holding. From the Canadian War Museum, Yasmin Minge, and her wonderful team, Pam Bowles and Jarrett Bartlett. Thank you so much. And most of all, thank you for making the time to come out to this this first Peter Stursberg Foreign Correspondents Lecture. I hope we see you all next year. Safe travels home. Thank you.